Well, actually, I mean, it's not any harder, to be honest with you. You just yelling into the camera. Okay, so it's not any harder. It's just, you know, you just follow the steps, turn the crank. Okay, so I guess I'm gonna go change the socks. Okay, so a couple of things. So today is hopefully going to leave you feeling pretty good because you're going to get an interpretation of some of the stuff you've been doing. And then we're going to see some neat things you can do with these ideas. But before we get into that, let me just very quickly kind of follow up on that thing that I mentioned in the homework where if you derive the gradient of a scalar and the divergence of a vector field in spherical polar coordinates and you compare it to your E&M books, you're going to get different results. And I don't want to go through an elaborate explanation of this, but I at least want to show you why you're seeing something different. So first of all, my claim is that in the E&M texts that you typically see, they use what's called an orthonormal set of basis vectors. So they use an orthonormal set of basis vectors, whereas in our class, we're using a coordinate basis. Okay, so let me just actually motivate for you the essential difference in these two and what it is about a coordinate basis that makes it different from this and how you translate between them. So the idea is essentially we are using a vector as being expanded in a set of components with a set of basis vectors. And you can alternatively expand this in what we will call an orthonormal basis, which I'll just indicate with little hats to say, you know, they have a normality condition, there's a perpendicularity notion there, and then they're also normalized to unit, or these are normalized to unit length. And then these are the corresponding components if you use the normal lengths. Now, to give you an idea of what kind of normalization condition we have, what I'm going to do is make the following observation. Suppose I wanted to know what this was equal to, okay? I would argue to you that, or even two different ones, it doesn't matter, but we're particularly interested in the case when it's not zero. I would argue that you can actually figure out what this is using just component notation. Okay, so how would we do that? Well, first of all, I forgot my most favorite part of the day. I have to get my cards out to kill you with. Okay, so if I wanted to, so we got Will, Jack, Matt, David's stopped coming and asking me questions. Hannah's not even in here anymore. Jacob, Gus, David's not in here, Spencer, John, that's going to be fun. Joe and Emily. All right, those are my victims for today. Anyway, if I wanted to express this vector, or just let's say that the index mu goes from 1, 2, 3, just to give it specific numbers. If I wanted to express that basis vector in component form, what would I use for my VUs? So this thing would be a vector with components of what? So remember, this is what the vector is, and I want just E1. So what would V mu? What would my set of V mu's be?
V over.
Say it again.
V over basis vectors.
Just be E1.
No, all that I want is this. I don't want a coefficient. I want the coefficient to be 1. So my set of V mu's should be 1, 0, 0. Does everybody see that? Because if I plug in that set of components here, and then I do this sum, I'll get E1 plus 0 plus 0. So I'll just get E1. You on board with that? Okay, so now we can ask ourselves, what is V mu? What is the size of a vector expressed in component form like this? Well, that's V mu, V nu, G mu nu. We know how to do that, right? Again, I want to work with components. Okay? Well, if the vector has components 1, 0, 0, then Will is going to be glad to tell me what this gives you. So for this particular vector, what does this give you?
1.
How do you?
Because take the metric part. I mean, is that not what that gives?
This is an arbitrary metric.
It gives you the length of the vector, though, right?
It does.
Which is 1.
No. The length of the vector is the size of the components in conjunction with the form of the metric. Okay, let's just go down the list. Zach.
3.
Matthew Martin.
G11.
Yes, this gives me G11. Good job.
Size.
Say it again.
How is that the size of the vector?
Because the vector is
a component.
So let's put this in here. So this guy is 1, 0, 0. This is the metric. And then this guy is 1, 0, 0. Now multiply that out.
Yes, you get G11.
You get G11, exactly. That's the size of the square of this thing. But remember that this entire story has to play out if we go back and we restore these things. So what we're calculating, so what I'm doing is I'm giving you in the language we've been using, the component language, what the size of this thing is. It's G11. But if we actually go back and we ask, all right, restoring the basis vectors, what we're actually calculating is exactly E1.E1 is what I guess I should write. So the dot product of these is G11. And in fact, if I put in any mu, you're just going to get the corresponding component of the metric.
This is the greatest.
Spencer.
Why wouldn't that be like the length of the square? Like, don't you think the square root in there or something?
Sorry. So, yes, it's not the length. It's the length squared of the vector. I'm sorry. If I was saying length, then I misspoke. It's the length squared of the vector. Just like this is not the length of one of these basis vectors. It's the length squared of a basis vector. Okay. So, last night in office hours, we were talking about this, and I kept writing this expression down. And all I'm showing you is where this expression comes from in the component language that we were using in the course. This might seem a little foreign because we never actually use these basis vectors. Matthew.
Did this work for any arbitrary e mu dot e lambda?
Yeah. Okay, and that would be the normality condition.
Are these are lower subscript mu's on the e's, so then are the basis vectors cotangent vectors?
No. So the that's the confusing part. Vector components have an upper index, basis vectors have a lower index. If you have a dual vector, then the components have a lower index and the basis dual vectors have an upper index.
Is there a reason why we do that? Why we choose our notation that way?
We choose our notation this way because generally we want to employ this idea that when we sum over an index, which we secretly do here, mm-hmm. we always want them to be in upper-lower pairs. And if we're going to have vector indices be upper and they're summed in conjunction with the basis vectors, we need to label the basis vectors with a lower index. Ariel.
Does that mean that if the...
hold on. You notice you would never confuse this with this. Right. This is labeling a number,
yeah.
A component of a dual vector, but this is labeling a basis vector. So the fact that these both have lower indices might seem like it could be confusing, but this is a different kind of thing than this. This is labeling which basis vector you're dealing with. This is an object with as many components as you have dimensions. This is just one number. Ariel, sorry.
Yeah. So does that mean that if you're using a non-diagonal metric, you're working in a non-orthogonal?
You can be, yeah. Okay. So once we have this statement in mind, you can now say, well, what does it mean to work in an orthonormal basis? Well, working in an orthonormal basis means what it usually means, and that is that if I take two basis vectors, or I take a basis vector and dot it with itself, this should always give me 1, no matter what the metric of the space is. Okay? So now what this means is if I look at these two expressions, I can immediately translate between the coordinate basis and the orthonormal basis, because I see that if I take my coordinate basis vector to be the square root of g mu mu times the orthonormal basis vector, then my coordinate basis vectors will satisfy the normalization condition that we've been using. Does everybody see that? If I dot this with itself, well, this is just going to give me 1, and then this is going to give me g mu mu. Okay? But now we can take this, and we can actually, if we like, we can reverse this and say that e mu hat is 1 over g mu mu times this, and we can plug that into here. Yeah. We can plug that into here and say, all right, v mu hat over root g mu mu is now expressing the components of this vector, all right, in terms of the components in the orthonormal basis in conjunction with these corrections from the metric. And then what you can do is you can just say, okay, that guy and these have to be the same. And this lets you switch back and forth between the components of a vector in the coordinate basis and the corresponding components in the orthonormal basis. So what you calculated in your homework were expressions using these components, but what the E&M books use is expressions in terms of these components. But now you can just translate them, because if you want what these look like in the orthonormal, you just multiply by the square root of the metric factor and shove them into what you got in your homework, and you should get what you saw in your E&M books. Okay, I don't want to spend a lot of time on this because it's not going to play out too much in this course, but in making a connection with things that you've seen, that's sort of an important technical detail. Okay, so now what I want to do, and by the way, if you like, you should certainly take the time to take the results of your homework and kind of force them into what you see in your E&M books. And I wrote it up in the solution, and it's also going to appear in the notes here, you've got examples of it if you don't want to take the time and do it yourself. I.e. you are lazy. You're not lazy. I don't think you're lazy. Okay, so now comes the cool part. Now comes the part where I actually explain to you what the hell you've been doing. So what is really going on? Well, first of all, we've constructed this derivative of, say, a vector. We know how to write this derivative on an arbitrary tensor, but let me just focus on vectors for a moment. And we know that the form of this is the following. It's a vector, so we use plus our Christoffel. And by the way, this is one of the few things that I actually remember in this class. A lot of things I looked them up because it's too many indices to remember. But when you're writing this down, this part should be pretty simple because you just copy this and make the del a d. When you're coming over to write down the rest of it, when you start writing the Christoffel symbol, the first thing you should do is give it the same upper index you gave to the vector. Okay? And then this thing is going to act on a vector, but you need to give this a new index, so maybe call it alpha, and then you just come in here and you fill in the rest of what you need. You know you need a mu, and you need to get rid of that alpha, bam, you're done. And if you screw up and write these backwards, Jacob, does that make a difference?
Nope,
because this is symmetric in exchange of those two, so you could even get that wrong, and you'd still get an A plus 100 in the course with a smiley face and a gold star. Okay, so... So one can argue that this derivative, which bear in mind, this is the derivative of a vector field. So we have in mind that there's a, you have a space and you have vectors at every point in that space. That's what a vector field is. We're not talking about like the velocity vector of a car. We're talking about a vector field, like an electric field or a magnetic field, vector fields, okay? What this is telling us is how that vector field is changing as we move around in the space. Okay? It's doing what the normal derivative of a vector field would do. But let's actually interpret how this change can occur, and it turns out it can occur in two different ways. So so let me see, I'll do this in two different places. So I'll start over here. So let's just pretend we have our space. And what we're going to do is we're going to take a vector here, and then we're going to have another vector up here. And those are going to be, they're clearly different vectors, right? If you look at these two things, they're different vectors. Everybody agree with that? So I would argue that del mu v nu should be not equal to zero, at least when I'm looking at comparing the vectors at this location and this location. Okay? Now, there's two ways for this to happen. I can set up my basis vectors. So here I might have a basis vector E1 and a basis vector E2. Here I have an E1, here I have an E2. Okay? But there's another way that this can happen. This is going to be hard, but I'm going to do it. I know I can do it. You guys have faith in me?
No.
Did you say no? Which jerk hole said no? And that's your pictures first. So Jacob's, oh, Jacob. Coming from you, I'll just, whatever. All right, so sorry, let me give this a little bit more tilt. Okay, so I can do this. I've got faith, despite the fact that Jacob has faith. Okay. Now, in both cases, I would argue that this is not zero, because if you just look at the vector, it's changed. Everybody agree?
Yeah.
Okay. However, in this machinery, the change is coming about from two different places. In this case, what we find is that if I look at how the components of the vector change, that is, if I look at d mu v nu, you notice that the E1 component of this vector is different when I go from here to here. So in this case, this is not zero. Everybody on board? However, in this case, I've been very careful to pick my basis so that the E1 component in this case is the same as the E1 component in this case. So in this picture, d mu v nu equals zero. I'm asking, how do the components of the vector change when I go from here to here, and the components do not change? Yes.
And you're assuming the length of the vectors are the same?
Yeah, I'm assuming the lengths are the same, and I'm just changing orientation. We can accommodate changing lengths in more complicated scenarios. Right now, I'm looking at a very special case to give some interpretation here. Okay? Now, we have an issue, right? Because the whole covariant derivative needs to not be zero in both cases. We've already got something that's not zero here, but this is equal to zero. But you know what? That's okay, because that's not the whole covariant derivative. So what we find is, in this case, it's actually the gamma nu mu alpha v alpha that's not equal to zero. And in this case, it turns out that this is zero. So now we can interpret what these two pieces of the covariant derivative are actually telling us. The first piece is saying, how do the components transform as I move from one location to another? Now, that can look weird because, say, in this picture, everything is kind of changing, but you have to look at the vector with respect to the basis at each point, and the components are the same. This piece is capturing what, Gus?
Which piece?
This piece.
Well, I guess it would make up for everything that it needs to.
Yes, and in making up for everything it needs to, what is it describing? What is it describing the change of?
coordinate change?
It's describing the change of the basis. So notice here, the basis is the same at the two points. You have no change in the basis. That's what this measures. Here, though, the basis is changing, and that's why this is non-zero. Alex?
There's no explicit reason from this diagram that the connection part would be zero in the left case. Is that a separate proof that that part ends up being zero? They could both be non-zero and sum to non-zero.
So in this case, because I drew these bases the same in both cases, this would be zero, because this measures the change in basis. Now, it doesn't have to be zero, because I could let these bases change and I could let the components change. I mean, in general, you can have both of these be non-zero.
Right.
But I specifically constructed this example so that in this case, it's the same basis at each point, and in this case, it's the same components at each point. Is that?
Right. There's just no guarantee that that would be zero. We're giving an interpretation that because that part is zero, therefore it refers to the basis vectors. But what's the root of the reason that that's zero? I feel like you'd have to go through and prove that externally.
You're right. I'm not giving a rigorous proof of this, and I'm not going to.
Okay, that's fine.
I just want you to see in this simple example where what is measuring what these effects are, or what each of these terms is essentially measuring. There's definitely a more rigorous way to do this. I completely agree with you, but we're not going to do it here. Yeah.
So could we look at this like the left-hand picture would be using, for example, Cartesian coordinates, so the metric is trivial and the connection is zero. On the right-hand side, it's polar or spherical where we change the...
Exactly. So, and mind you, I don't necessarily have to... Okay, so... Let me not jump ahead. So what Martin just said is exactly the point. If we're in flat space and we use Cartesian coordinates, then the bases are the same at all points. Okay? We can set up what's called a global basis, and it looks the same no matter where you go. You all know that if you're in flat space and you use polar coordinates, say r and theta, then as you move around from point to point, this basis set changes direction. And that's why when you look at derivative operators in polar coordinates, you have to use these Christoffel symbols because they're generally non-zero. Okay? So what we're doing is we're sort of finessing out the different ways that a vector can change, or that the components of a representation of a vector can change. I want to stress to you that let me draw my second set of pictures, because now I have to, let me draw my second set of pictures, because I'm trying to explain this all and I've only told you half the story. So here's the second half of the story. Okay, see if I can do this. This should actually be easier, okay? So what I'm going to do now is something very similar. Spencer, you're way off on the side, so this might look a little bit weird, but if you look at this vector and if you look at this vector, and I ask you, what's the change as I go from here to here, what does it look like?
Zero.
It looks like zero. What about in this case?
Non-zero.
Say it again?
It's non-zero.
It's supposed to be. So if I take this vector, they're supposed to look the same. Sorry if...
Okay, but like...
Well, they're supposed to be the same. I might have drawn them not great.
The vectors look the same still. Right?
Don't look at all the other crap on the board. Oh, just look at this arrow and this arrow. Don't worry about anything else.
I thought the point was to look at the reference.
No, don't look at any of that yet. I'll ask about that in a minute.
Okay.
This arrow compared to this arrow.
They don't look like they're different, yeah.
Oh, they don't look... they're different. You're killing me. Okay, that's zero. All right, I'm going to have to get more cards out. You guys are killing me. Okay, all right. Now, and John, where's John?
One.
Gil, Will.
He's sick.
He's sick. He's got an F in his class. Would have gotten on his case. Bryce. All right. There we go. I had both Johns on deck, so one of you is going to get it. Okay. So here, what's that?
Zero.
It's zero because notice the components of the vector in each point are the same. What is this? John, you get a twofer.
Should be zero, right? Or non-zero.
So what does this tell you about?
The change of the basis. So zero.
Yeah, it's zero. Well, guess what? The math works out. Zero plus zero is zero. All right, Robin, exactly. All right, Joe, you ready?
I suppose.
You ready? In this picture, what is this? Zero or non-zero?
Non-zero?
You tell, that's coming or telling me?
I thought that was a statement.
I gotta say this because it's gonna go on YouTube. I went to elementary school with this kid named Ashley Turpin. He was categorically incapable of answering a question without an interrogative tone. So it, like, you would ask him his name and he'd go, Ashley? It was so fun. Anyway, okay. You're all going to Google Ashley Turpin now. I forgot who it is. Okay, what about that?
Same as before. It's not zero.
It's not It's not zero, yeah. So you'll notice the components have changed, okay? Just think about the angle the vector makes with respect to the basis. So that's why this is not zero, but the basis has changed. That's why this is non-zero. But folks, if these are going to add together to give you zero, if this is not zero, this better be not zero. Okay? Does everybody see that? Okay, so I'm just giving this to you just to sort of let you see how we interpret this kind of complicated looking thing. But it's a necessary evil because we often use coordinate systems and their coordinate adapted basis vectors where the basis vectors are actually changing in space, and all these things are doing is keeping track of that and allowing us to make meaningful comparisons to.
Does this also let us say that the del mu v nu thing is equal and opposite to the Christoffel junk?
Yeah, these are equal and opposite. Therefore, if one of them is non-zero, the other one better be non-zero. Yeah. Okay. All right. Okay, so I need to get some more people up on deck here. So we've got this covariant derivative. It uses these Christoffel symbols. You've kind of got an idea of how to compute them. You can certainly compute them with Mathematica, and in the future you might be wanting to do that. For diagonal metrics, there's a pretty straightforward formula that you can use, so you can do some cases by hand, but in general, you know, there's a lot of these things, and so in higher dimensions, in particular, you might want to use Mathematica to calculate them. Now let's see some of the things we can do with this derivative, because, you know, it would suck if we had spent as much time as we've spent developing a derivative if we can't really get much out of it. But it turns out we get a lot out of this derivative. I mean, a lot. Like, several weeks of material out of it. So let's get some victims now.
Throw out the people that aren't here.
What?
Throw out the cards of like Hannah and the people that don't.
I know. I like their faces. I just can't throw anybody away. I'm a keeper. I mean, I'm a keeper of people.
A hoarder.
A hoarder. The guy in the silence of the lambs.
Rub lotion on his skin. Rubs against the hose again.
Right. So what can we do with del? So del, if you think about it, del, I just drew all these pictures where I drew a vector here and I drew a vector there, and I was using del to kind of talk about like how things are changing. But if you think about it, this is actually kind of addressing something which we said was going to be a subtle thing in curved spaces, and that's this idea that I don't think I'm going to say this later. Let me go ahead and say this. Because I don't have it in my notes, and I need to go ahead and say it to you. So somebody asked me at the beginning of class, I can't remember who it was, if you're in flat space and you're using Cartesian coordinates, what are the gammas? What are the Christoffel symbols?
Not zero.
They're all zero. They're all zero because, remember, these things are built out of the inverse metric with a bunch of derivatives of the metric, and I can't remember. This is one of those that I don't remember. Well, in Cartesian coordinates in flat space, the metric is 1, 1, 1. Similarly, in Minkowski space, in Cartesian coordinates, the metric is minus 1, 1, 1. All of the gammas are 0, okay? If you're in flat space, but you use curvilinear coordinates, say with r theta phi, in that case, the gammas are not 0. Okay? So the gammas are useful in flat space if you go to curvilinear coordinates. However, you can go to a curved space, and in a curved space, there's no way to escape it. You're going to have to deal with non-zero gammas. Okay? So you've used the gammas before in your ENM class, but you weren't doing curved space in ENM, you were doing flat space, you were just using curvilinear coordinates. However, in this class, we're gonna look at curved spaces, and in curved spaces, there's no coordinate system you can pick where globally all the gammas are gonna be zero. Okay? Now, that actually poses an interesting question, because imagine if you started in this space with these coordinates and gamma was zero. So just give this some indices so that we have something to play around with. Now suppose I did a coordinate transformation to r theta phi, which I can do. That's just a coordinate transformation. Let's transform gamma. If I start with zero, what do I end up with?
You're missing part of that.
What do I end up with? According to what I've written.
Zero.
Yeah, but didn't we just say that you have non-zero Christoffel symbols in spherical polar coordinates?
It doesn't transform like tensor.
Exactly. This is not how the Christoffel symbol transforms. You get this plus a bunch of these. These are not going to be zero. So you're going to generate non-zero Christoffel symbols from zero Christoffel symbols precisely because the Christoffel symbol is not a tensor. It has this funky inhomogeneous piece to its transformation. Okay? I felt that was important enough to point out explicitly. Okay, back to what we can do with this. All right. So if the covariant derivative is somehow allowing us to meaningfully compare vectors at different points, then somehow this must have some information about transporting a vector which lives in one tangent space to the location of a vector which lives in a different tangent space. So to appreciate this and what is actually going on, let's first of all just consider the more formal limit definition of derivatives. So if I take the basic derivative, say like that, and I want to evaluate it at, for example, the location of x mu, then I can think of this as the limit as an infinitesimal displacement goes to zero of the difference of the vector at x mu plus that displacement minus the vector at x mu over epsilon mu. Okay, this should look very similar to the formal definition of the derivative of the limit that you saw in calculus 1, for example. Okay, the problem with this interpretation is, how do we subtract meaningfully vectors at different locations? In flat space, this is perfectly meaningful, because if you pick a Cartesian coordinate system, the tangent spaces at all points are actually degenerate, and you can actually just take two separated vectors and you can subtract them. Okay? But this just doesn't really feel like it's a good thing to do if you're on a curved space, or if you might be working with the basis that change as you move around. Okay? However, this is not the right derivative anyway. What we want to talk about is del mu v nu. So what we have going on here is the limit as some displacement interval is going to zero, and one very minor thing is going to change. Emily, what changed? So what changed in these two expressions? You guys know the reverse conspiratory wink? No friend taught me that.
Did you write this one with a French accent?
Yes, nothing changed. They're actually the exact same expression. Now I'm going to change them. I know, you're like, he added like skid marks. What's up with that? Okay, so what we have in mind is the following. So I'm going to give you a formal definition of this in words. So what this means is, I want to subtract two vectors that are at different locations. Now that poses a problem, because those vectors in principle live in different Hilbert spaces. So what this is giving to us is a formal means to compare vectors at two different locations. And the idea is the following. We take this vector at this location, and we transport it to this location. But in transporting the vector, we keep it parallel to itself. So this is something called parallel transport. So let me draw a picture of what parallel transport looks like. So let's start with a vector v nu that's sitting at the location x mu plus epsilon mu. And then I want to compare it to a vector down here, which might be v nu at the location x mu. Okay? So this location here is the point x mu plus epsilon mu, and this location here is the point x mu. Now what I want to do is I want to move this vector to this point. But as I move it, I want this vector to remain as parallel to itself as it can. And that as it can is going to be very important later on. So in this simple picture, I just grab this thing, bring it all the way down. It gets there. And now what I have is the parallel transported version of the vector at this location.
Like purposely a little skewed?
No, it's me just like,
okay.
Not awesome.
Right.
I didn't take my awesome pill this morning. And now that these two vectors are defined at the same point, I can meaningfully subtract them. This all looks pretty silly in this particular example, but you'll see cases in just a minute where this makes a huge difference. Okay? So again, if I want to parallel transport a vector from one location to another, I grab it and I move it along a path, keeping it as parallel to itself as I possibly can. Now, that those words, like, and drawing pictures might seem a little obtuse, but we actually have a very formal way of doing this mathematically, and it's using this derivative, okay?
Could you have parallel transported the other one instead?
You could have if, well, no, well, you want to do the difference at this location. So you want to get them both to the point x mu. So you want to move this guy to that location. You can so this is parallel transport in the context of the derivative. You can literally just take a vector and parallel transport it without talking about derivatives, if you like. You could just say, what happens if I parallel transport this from here to here? But parallel transport is an important part of derivatives because it involves taking differences of vectors at different points, and so you have to somehow get them to the same location. Okay? So now what we want to do is actually get a formal definition mathematically of what this picture means using this covariant derivative. Okay? So let me... Yeah. So let's use what we know about covariant derivatives to actually mathematize this thing, okay? So suppose we want to parallel transport a vector v mu along a curve, and many of you might have objected and said, well, why do you have to go along this path? Can you take other paths, okay? Well, we're actually going to write down the definition for an arbitrary path. So if I have a curve, say x mu parameterized by lambda, we want to figure out if I have this thing at one value and I want to on this curve and I want to move it to another value along this curve, how do I formally do that? So to start, remember that we have this derivative associated with curves called the directional derivative along the curve. And we can break this thing up into its components. Okay? And remember, this thing tells us if the curve x mu is, say, like that, so as you change lambda, you're moving along this curve, if I have some function which is defined everywhere, this derivative is telling me how this function changes for values along the curve, as I move along the curve, okay? Now, this is not actually going to be any good for us, because you'll notice this is built out of this crappy old thing, which is non-tensorial. So we're going to need to replace this with something that's tensorial. How do you think we're going to do that? Is Justin still in the class? Annie, how am I going to make this tensorial?
We're going to use the gamma thingy.
Yes, and how is it going to enter into this? So which part of this is broken?
The d mu.
The d mu. So how do we get a tensorial derivative? Yeah, you turn it into del. So we're going to define a new directional derivative called capital D by d lambda, and that's going to be defined very similarly, except we're going to use the covariant derivative instead of the ordinary partial derivative. Okay. So we had talked about this directional derivative back before we were really worrying about whether the derivative was a tensor in arbitrary coordinates. We're trying to fix that oversight now. Before we proceed, yes, Rob?
I thought the partial derivative did transform neatly. It was the partial derivative acting like on a tensor that was the problem.
Sure, but this is going to act on something.
Okay, so.
Yeah.
I thought everything we did with the normal derivative was okay. So, like when we worked with it before, there weren't any problems in the math and so on that we did before. When we used these particular expressions. Like you went through and proved that that was the case. Now it seems like you're saying that that's not sufficient. Like in the manifold discussion and so on, it worked for all of those things. Was it just because we're now applying it to a tensor?
Yeah, in the manifold case, we use this expression to build up the basis of the tangent space, arguing that the set of directional derivatives through a point space is essentially the set of tangent vectors, all the tangent vectors passing through that point. And then if any tangent vector can be expressed as a set of components times these things, then these remain a natural basis in the tangent space. And so now the question is, do we instead need to think of this as defining the basis in the tangent space? And yeah, I'm going to have to think about that one, Alex. That's a good question. Because you're right, in our discussion of manifolds,
I don't even think we applied it to the tensor.
Well, let me not try and figure it out on the spot, because I won't. And I'll spin my wheels being confused, but I'll explain it to you next time.
Okay.
So, but yeah, that's a good point. Like, we didn't worry about this when we were using this to set up a tangent space basis on a point and arbitrary manifold, whether it's curved or not. Why do we suddenly have to worry about it now? I have to think about it. Okay, but bearing in mind that this thing is non-tensorial when it acts on a tensor. Okay, it's tensorial if it acts on a scalar, but we want to be able to take the directional derivative of anything. Oh! That's why! Thank you. Yes, when we did this for the manifolds, we used a scalar function. And for a scalar function, this is a tensorial derivative. But we want to be able to take the derivative of an arbitrary tensor. And that's where we have to bring in this complication. High five, Alex. Thank you. All right, good job. Okay, so back to this. Yeah. Okay, so for an arbitrary tensor, we need to bump this thing up to this covariant directional derivative. And now what we can do is let's actually write out what this looks like. So this is going to be dx mu d lambda partial mu of something plus dx mu d lambda. So excited because I got that. I got that right. Galen mu, and then some dot dots. And remember, I can't put in what these indices are until I actually let this act on something. That's our usual story with the Christoffel. And then I'm actually going to be sneaky and reverse the order of these, which I could do because everything's in index notation. And you'll understand why I did that in just a second. Okay. So now what we're going to argue is the following. To parallel transport a vector along the curve parameterized by lambda, we are simply going to insist that the covariant directional derivative of the vector be zero. That is, we want the vector to remain unchanged as we move it along the path.
You're saying as parallel as possible earlier. This seems like perfectly parallel.
You'll understand the difference in a minute. In all the pictures I'm drawing to you, this doesn't seem to make a difference, but you'll understand in a minute. Okay? But there's meat in this because, again, if we actually blow this covariant directional derivative up into this expression, we find that this becomes... So I'm gonna abbreviate it. So this guy is just the ordinary directional derivative corrected by the Christoffel symbols, which we can now assign indices to. So I'm literally just taking this expression and I'm dropping a V nu in it everywhere. except I'm putting it, be row there, putting new there and row there, as I need to do when I'm assigning the values to the Christoffel symbol indices.
Alex, yeah. So when we're saying the directional derivative is zero, is that true for an arbitrary path, or do we have to pick our paths such that that's true?
No, this is for any path, okay. X mu lambda.
Okay.
As we move the vector along that path, we're insisting that the directional derivative be zero. That's what it means to parallel transport along that path. Okay. Parallel transporting along different paths can give you different things, and we'll see an example in a second. Okay. So now we can obviously, by what we know for how all of this generalizes to tensors, we can give the directional derivative now for an arbitrary tensor, which, to keep it simple, we'll just look at a 1-1 tensor. So if I want to parallel transport, say, a 1-1 tensor, I just demand that the covariant directional derivative along the path, and again, all of this is transporting along the path parameterized by lambda. If I want to transport a tensor along that path, then I demand that the derivative is zero, and we know what that looks like. So we have the directional, or the normal directional derivative of the tensor, and then, as you might guess, we add in the appropriate Christoffel symbols for each of these indices, remembering that if it's a dual vector index, it comes in with a minus sign. And so this is going to end up being something god-awful. Actually, this is probably the best way to interpret it. Dx mu, d lambda, and then just del mu of t alpha beta. And then we can break up del mu t alpha beta into d mu t alpha beta plus a Christoffel symbol for the vector index, and then I'm going to have mu nu t nu beta minus a Christoffel symbol with the dual vector index, so t alpha beta gamma delta, I can do this, mu nu. Okay. Yeah, I think I even got that right.
Maybe mu beta?
Oh man, you're kidding me.
The last one.
Yeah, it should be mu beta. I copied down those. I was being sloppy. Yeah, it should be mu beta always. Alright. So how do we use parallel transport? Like, how do we use this equation? Like, what does this mean? Okay.
I don't know how to use it.
Okay, so the way that we actually use this is as follows. If I give you the value of the tensor at some point along the curve, say x mu at lambda naught, and I give you the curve itself, so I give you the value at any point on the curve, and then the actual curve, this is just a differential equation. And solving it gives you the functional form of t alpha beta parallel transported along that curve. So to parallel transport something along a curve, all I do is give you an initial condition of the value at one point along the curve, and then you solve the differential equation to get the values at any other point along the curve. Right.
So you can plug in any lambda and get the parallel tensor out of that?
So we have to be careful about something, because this idea gets a little confusing. Let me see what I can, I'm going to erase this. So. And I might have had cause to say this later on, but I want to go ahead and say this. Okay. We can have a vector field. And what I mean by that is we might have a space, and say there's like an electric field in that space. So at this point, there's an electric field vector. And at this point, there's an electric field vector. And at this point, why I started with E, with x naught is beyond me. That's going to be 3, that's going to be 2, that's going to be 1. So everywhere, in every point in space, there's an electric field vector, okay? And then you can imagine a path through this space, okay? These are not related by parallel transport. They just happen to be the actual vector field that you have. Parallel transport is what you do when you say, I want to take this electric field vector at this location and move it to that location. So I pick a point on the curve. This is x, my x mu naught. I take the vector at that location. I have the path. And then I solve this differential equation, and I plug in the lambda that corresponds to that point, and it tells me what this vector parallel transported to that would look like.
Well, once you get that one equation, you can plug in any lambda.
Sure, yeah. Okay. And you can figure out the parallel transported version at any lambda. Yes?
Cool. Is it conservative? As in, does it matter what the curve is if the endpoints are the same?
Well, let's talk about that. So we'll end with a couple of very interesting things that you can do with the covariant derivative, and then when we meet next time, and this will just take a minute, when we meet next time, we'll actually see how you implement some of this stuff. So I would argue that this idea of parallel transport is incredibly useful for a couple of reasons. First of all, parallel transport rules because parallel transport rules because A, it is, and this we already know, it's an intrinsic part of a meaningful derivative. Okay, we need a meaningful tensorial derivative, and this is actually implementing parallel transport. So we already know that. Another reason why it rules is it is sensitive to curvature. Actually, it can detect curvature. So let me show you an argument for how the parallel transport can detect curvature. First of all, we need a curved surface. Everybody agree that's a curved surface?
Sure is.
That's our simplest one. So the surface of a two-sphere is a curved surface, okay? So let's start with flat space, see what it looks like, and then we'll do this in the curved space. So in flat space, if I take a vector and I take a curve and I parallel transport the vector along the curve, I get something like that, okay? And you can draw the little arrows and everything, it makes sense, okay? If I pick a different curve, say that curve, and I parallel transport this vector along that curve to that same point, I get the same vector. So in flat space, parallel transporting between two points does not depend on what curve you're looking at. So it's conservative in that sense. But let's look at what happens on curved space. So let's start at the North Pole with a vector, again, it has to be tangent to the space, which just points, say, along that direction. So I have in mind it's tangent and it's kind of along that direction. And I want to parallel transport it along a great circle down to the equator, keeping it as parallel to itself as I can. Now this is very important because as we move down the curve, the vector has to remain tangent to the space. It can't poke out of the surface of the sphere because it has to live in the tangent. Well, now let's take it and move it along the equator. And now let's take it back to Santa Claus. You notice what's happened? It's different. I've taken this vector around a closed path, but when I get back to the North Pole, it's pointing in a different direction. In flat space, if I take the vector around a closed path, because it's path independent, I have to get back to the same direction I'm pointing originally. So what we find is if I parallel transport a vector around a closed path and it comes back to itself in a different direction, it's actually reflecting the fact that the space it's moving on is curved. And we will use this to identify curvature explicitly in due time. The other thing that this is useful for, and Jacob, I'm going to answer your question in just a second because I want to get this third point out. The other thing that we can use parallel transport for is it helps, or it can be used to define, and this is going to seem like, where the hell did that come from? It defines geodesics. And geodesics in this class are important because geodesics are the paths taken by objects under the influence of gravity. A very, very important half of this course is you figure out how space gets curved. That's Einstein's equations. We'll learn what those look like. But then once space is curved, how does that affect the motion of particles? Well, they follow geodesic paths. But you can define geodesics using this notion of parallel transport. That's not obvious right now, but we'll use this machinery to see that next time.
Well, so this actually goes into the question I was going to ask, because it seemed like there should be a preferred path, probably the geodesic type of thing. But that's where it goes around and returns unaltered. But it seems like not only the direction could be mutated, but so could the magnitude. For instance, if I take the vector here and make as much parallel as possible when I go 90 degrees, there's now no, in order for it to have any parts still parallel to the original vector, it would now have to be pointing completely perpendicular outward on the sphere, which isn't in that space. So it seems like the magnitude should have been brought to zero when you brought it down to the equator.
Only live in the tangent space.
Yeah, you can only live in the tangent
space. That's the point, because now the previous space on top of the circle has this much here. Now, as I go down to the sphere, I'm living in this space.
You're trying to let your vector live in the R3 embedding space, and you're trying to only track the component that's along the surface of the sphere. So you're saying this thing lives in R3. This vector is pointing in a certain direction, and I'm only hanging on to that component. And that's why that component seems to be good. But you have to understand, R3 doesn't exist.
Oh, I see.
The only thing that exists is the surface of the sphere. There's no component along the surface. The whole thing sits in the surface of the sphere.
Okay.
So that's the way you have to think about this parallel transport. Otherwise, and we'll actually see an important application of what happens when you have an embedding space next time. But yeah, be really careful about how you interpret that. All right, that's enough for today. I'll see you guys on Thursday.
Yes.